second eye. I need to get my story straight. My friends are in the bathroom getting higher than the Empire State. My lover, she is waiting for me just across the bar. My seat's been taken by some sunglasses asking about a scar. And I know I gave it to you months ago. I know you're trying to forget. But between the drinks and subtle things, the holes in my apologies, you know, I'm trying hard to take it back. So if by the time the bar closes and you feel like falling down, I'll carry you home tonight.
Welcome, students, parents, honored guests, and fellow staff and faculty. It is an honor to be invited to speak today. Graduation is one of the few rites of passage we have to mark this entry into adulthood. It is an amazing thing to be an advisor to HB's student publications. Looking at you in the last 4 year books, the transformation of these boys and girls into young men and women, it's profound, really. As a new advisor to the Hollis Brookline yearbook, it's been my privilege to really get to know the graduating class, because the book, as it's called among yearbookers, must represent the essence of the class. So it's important to spend some time thinking like an anthropologist. Who are these people? Where do they come from? What are they like? The easy answer, the class of 2012 comes from apple orchards and bonfires, from Old Homes Day and Trebuchet Day, from a school where some of their parents had our very own Mr. Fox for English when they were in school. This is a school where dating, I've been told, is very tricky because everyone who grows up here is like your brother or sister. And many moms in our audience today claim you as part of their kids' particular puppy pile of kindergarten and day camp, of sleepovers, and recently as part of the parent paparazzi fest known as prom pictures. If we are honest, most of these kids can't wait to get out of here. Yet Hollis and Brookline are among the last remaining places bearing the stamp of safety and community that marks small New England towns. It is a good place to be from, a rare one, a place where you are known and cared about by so many. But we do understand your need to see more, to do more, discover more, and that is all we want for you. To address my question, what is the class of 2012 like? I must first address you near graduates, what you are not like. To echo other speakers today, you are not 2012, the naughty, unspirited slackers you tried to convince us you were. Not at all. I am sorry, but you have failed miserably at not being a class we have grown to care about very deeply. You have not made it easy for us after today to forget any of you. And you have not made the Sunday after graduation any less painful for me when I finally sit down with my yearbook and read your words and remember things like Joey Hyatt's way of making anybody happier, or Lauren Pratt's elegance with words, Maggie Borkowski's dry wit, Casey Quinn's crazy dance moves that get everyone going on the senior trip. How can I say goodbye to any of you, to Meg Graves and her gifted design and artwork? To multi-talented students like Eric Sekules, who had a way of always being somewhere with his camera, showing us who you really are, 2012. When I flip through the pages of the book, this is what I see. You are warm. You belong to each other. You are great friends, and you are great at being friends. You are, male and female alike, huggers. You have as many powerful bromances as there are girls who have pinky sworn to be best friends for life. And my friends of 2012, all of this is about to change. Much of what you think you are headed toward is going to shift, and many of the people you can't imagine life without will grow new friendships in new directions and new places, and so will you. You will always be from here, but this moment, this giddily beautiful day that I can call nothing less than a gift can only be visited once. Pay attention. Now, I offer you a verbal glimpse into my high school yearbook. Class of 1979, a Brandywine Bulldog. Also, our school colors were blue and white. I am the one on page 272 with a bad Farrah Fawcett haircut. Okay, most of us had bad Farrah Fawcett haircuts, but there's some others there. A few pages past my photo, there's Scott Rowe, the saxophone player on whom I had a mad crush for years. Where is he now? This guy who lived for music? He's in California with a few bands, a few albums, and many theme songs to TV shows such as 911 to his name. There's my best friend from high school, Fran Willing, NHS member and an introverted artist who's worked at the Metropolitan Museum of Art since college. Greg Savoy, that wild drummer in my creative writing class who I finally went out with, realized his dream of working in film and covered the wall that divided Germany when it finally fell. If I had a college yearbook, I'd show you a few from my small class of 50 from Boston University's School of Fine Arts, a program our very own Bailey DeLacy is headed for soon. On the pages of that book, you'd see Mike Chiklis of The Shield, The Commish, or The Fantastic Four, or Julianne Moore, who we knew as Julie, who won an Academy Award for her work in The Hours, who you might remember as the wife in Crazy Stupid Love. I'd show you Rosie O'Donnell's photo, but she left BU when the professor suggested she might not have what it takes to act. You wouldn't recognize Leslie Cavney, the girl in my acting class who cracked us all up because she switched from acting to screenwriting. You ever watch Everybody Loves Raymond? I always smile when I recognize a gag line that has her particular writing stamp on it. My point here is not to name drop, nor is it, dear parents, to suggest to your sons and daughters that they all run off to pursue dreams of being the next big actress, rock star, top model, or World Series championship pitcher. Although, you never know, one of them might be, or more. My point is that each one of these people found where his or her inner compass pointed to, and then followed that with a true passion. The world is full of talent, but these people listened for what was within them, and then they used the magic formula of talent plus consistent, unceasing effort plus vision. They kept listening within and pointing themselves, sometimes redirecting themselves, toward true north. To do what is within you will make you rich. Not in what you measure a bank account by, but what you measure a life with. What is your bliss, 2012? To what does your compass point? And if you don't know, many of us don't know at this point, I'm going to offer you two big questions. Questions I've always found will lead you to your own true north, to what it is you are here to do and become. First question, when you forget yourself, what are you doing? What is it about that activity that makes you happy? Is it the teamwork and pushing your limits? The creativity? The logic puzzle that you simply must untangle? Whatever you walk toward and eventually do, look for what includes these elements. The second compass question is this. If you won the lottery, if money were no object, what would you do? Now, how can you give yourself the very essence of this, even without $1 million? These are the questions that pointed me home to my true north and true work, to my calling, to teaching. And I think I can say the same for my colleagues. I left BU's theater program after 2 years because when I asked myself these questions, the answers were not in acting, but in directing, which pointed to teaching, and writing. When I forget myself, I'm helping people grow, usually through some creative process. Teaching is and has been my bliss for over 2 decades. I did not find my direction with my head, but through a much, much deeper listening, one I want for you. If I won the lottery today, I would still need to find a way to teach. I'd probably spend a little more time writing, and maybe I'd buy a historic home in my favorite Portsmouth neighborhood, but other than that, my life would not look much different. So my dearest wish for you, members of 2012, is meaningful work. No, not work, but calling. The thing in you that is both where you can give the most and where you feel the kind of reward that cannot be measured. Looking at you, 2012, who we have come today to bless and send off on their own quest for your own true norths, I see a class on whom my message isn't at all wasted. You are the class who has resisted being tested and measured, even if you do graduate as seniors from one of the best schools in the country. If I look at the tremendous successes of 2012, I love how sorely you have failed at being less than all you are. Even more, I have grown to love how you typify the senior song you finally agreed on, Good Life. While it may be the end of the world as you know it, the song some of you proposed which got vetoed, Good Life is what you have created here through your camaraderie, through your humor, and let's face it, through your decency of character. I believe good lives are what you are headed for. Should you ever lose your way, I ask you to remember this day, the families and friends who hold you in their care, and these two questions. When you lose yourself, what are you doing? If you won the lottery, what would you do? Some version of the essential answer to both will lead you not to a physical home like Dorothy's Kansas or this speck of a map called your hometown, but it will lead you to your true selves and the real gifts you go out to offer the world. So congratulations, class of 2012, and thank you for the gift you've offered all of us who have had the great pleasure to know you, to love you along the way. Poet Mary Oliver ends her poem, The Summer Day, with a challenge. What will you do with your wild and precious life? Finally, in the words of Ferris Bueller, remember, life moves pretty fast. If you don't stop and look around once in a while, you could miss it. We will miss you, 2012. Rock on, all you got.
Address the places at Abbey Road, take turns tonight, not turns to whatever we want. We're young enough to say,
vested in me by the state of New Hampshire, I now certify the class of 2012. Congratulations to the class of 2012. Please move your tassel from the right to the left. Congratulations.
Open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate.